You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Good afternoon, and welcome to Gardens of California. This is a live broadcast where we talk about plant materials, pest control, how to grow your garden, how to take care of your garden. We talk about plant groups. Throughout the semester, we're going to talk about citrus, oaks, camellias, mushrooms, all sorts of things. Everything pertaining to your garden, how to take care of your garden. So last week we talked about insects, and of course entomology is a big subject, and so I gave you kind of a brief overview of a variety of insects. When you talk about garden pests, we kind of separate the sucking insects and the chewing insects when it comes to thinking about control. But more about that in a minute. If you have a question about your garden, you can always call us at 1-800-339-1193, and we will be having a discussion today about colony collapse disorder in honeybees and the relationship of that particular problem with pesticides or other factors that are affecting it. But we like to start our show with upcoming events that you can put on your calendar. If you're a student in the class, then you need to attend an outside event where you learn something about gardening and then write a 1 to 2 page essay telling me what you learned. It could be going to a plant society or horticultural society, anything you want to pick. You can go to one of our events we list, but you can pick your own, but it should be educational and you should learn something about gardening. Let's take a look at our upcoming events. We have the Huntington Botanical Gardens Orchid Show and Sale is coming up on October 18th through 20th. That should be spectacular. These orchid shows are really a lot of fun. Lots of flowers, plants for sale, pots, books, everything you can think of. So that's Friday from noon to 4:30 and Saturday, Sunday, 10:30 to 4:30. So it's actually a 3-day show. There'll probably be speakers talking about different kinds of orchids, what type of orchids you can grow in Southern California easily, what kind of orchids that you can grow in Southern California with a lot of equipment, like a greenhouse. So that's a nice one. Give them a call if you want to let them know you're coming. What Tree Is That? At the Arboretum of Los Angeles County on October 5th and on November 9th from 10 to 12. I'm teaching that class. And on each Saturday, I introduce 20 new trees. And then, so that's an hour lecture on 20 new trees and then an hour walk in the garden to find the trees, or at least most of the trees, and then talk about the various trees in the garden. In addition to that, we have Winter Cactus Show and Sale will be at the Arboretum Los Angeles County on Sunday, November 2nd and 3rd. This is also a really fun show to attend. Lots of unusual cacti and succulents. It won't just be cactus. There'll also be a lot of succulents. They'll also have books and pots and potting mix and all sorts of things for sale. And there'll be lectures. So you can learn about our native cactus and maybe learn about cactus that are from South America or Central America, and learn something about plants that are probably a little more appropriate for our climate than a lot of things we grow. In addition to that, we have the Salvia pre-sale tour at the Fullerton Arboretum on Saturday, September 21st from 9 to 10. Salvia is a great genus and perfect really for a lot of uses in Southern California. There are salvias that'll get 5 to even 10 feet tall. There are little ones that get no bigger than maybe up to your ankle. There's annuals, there's perennials, great genus, highly hybridized, lots and lots of plant material to think about. So that would be a really fun event to attend and learn about salvia. Let's see if we have any more upcoming events. The Composting 2, Improving Your Skills at the Fullerton Arboretum will be Saturday, October 19th from 10 to 11. And you can learn how to compost the organic materials from your own garden, your leaf clippings, your grass clippings, your leaves, things like that, what to put in, what not to put in, how to get it to compost quickly. and the do's and don'ts of composting. In addition to that, let's see if we have an additional outside event. We have the Propagating California Native Plants Workshop at Rancho Santa Ana Botanic Gardens, which is also just a wonderful place to take a look and learn about natives. They are really the premier site for native plant materials in Southern California. And so if you take this class, you'll learn how to propagate them, either from cuttings or seeds, and of course how to grow them, where to put them in your garden. And they have an extensive nursery and they grow lots of natives. So that's a great place to get natives and good information on how to grow your native plants. Let's see if we have any more upcoming events, or is that going to be it? That's it for now. That's a lot. In fact, if you haven't been out to Rancho Santa Ana ever, if you live out in the east part of the county or in San Bernardino County, Riverside County, it is a fabulous garden. Not really a showy garden like the Huntington or Descanso or some of the other kind of old estate gardens, but a wonderful botanical garden filled with California natives. It is dedicated to plants that are from the California floristic province, so a wonderful place to go. I've been there a lot of times. Occasionally I'll teach classes there. Nice place, really nice. So we also like to have a mystery plant. In this case, it's a mystery genus. And if you're not familiar with what that term means, genus, all organisms get a two-part name. They get the first name is the genus. The second name is what's called the specific epithet. And a lot of people confuse the species with the specific epithet. But the species is both of them together. A perfect example would be Homo sapiens, which are people, man. Homo is man, and sapien means wise. That's debatable. But if you put them together, Homo sapien, that's our species. Another common example would be Camellia japonica. The genus is Camellia, the species is japonica, meaning it's native to Japan. You put them together, Camellia japonica, you have the species name. It's both names together constitute the species name. So today I just want the name of the genus. And let's take a look at this one right here, this little shrub. This is a woody shrub, this little one. And it's blooming, so I brought it in. Let's see if we can get a picture, a close-up of the flower. And this one is, this is a member of the genus. This genus is extremely widespread. It occurs on almost every continent in the world, perhaps not Antarctica. But this is actually one that's native to the tropics. And so the flower doesn't, if you look at it closely, you'll realize it is the same flower form for the whole genus. Now this one is tropical and a little tender. I'm just going to set that right there for now. And let me, here's another one that is also one of the tropical members of this genus. And there you can see it's got similar flowers. Now these are tender, so you got to be careful when you grow them. There you go. They're pretty. They're really nice. And these repeat bloom throughout the year. Now, if you're going to grow them in Southern California, you got to be careful because this particular group within this genus, the tropical ones, are a little more tender than this. Now, this is more typical of the genus. And a little hint is they're ubiquitous and common in the Pacific Northwest, so Washington, Oregon, Northern California. Maybe we could get a close-up of this flower. This is more typical of the genus, and this is the one that should kind of give it away. They often form these large kind of bundles or, balls of flowers. And they usually bloom in the spring. This particular species in this genus, this particular plant, will only bloom once in the spring. It's not going to repeat bloom. So if you can venture a guess, give us a call and tell us what you think this is. And hopefully someone will call up, but if they don't, I'll let you know at some point during the show. And we'll talk about how to grow them. Let me set this back down on the ground. This one's pretty tall. Of course, I have them in pots, so I can bring them in and show them on the show. But you can put them, of course, you can grow them in the ground. You just have to really prepare the soil well in order for them to do well. Now, last week we were talking about insects, and one of the insects I wanted to talk about, and I didn't get a chance to really talk about it very much, is the gold-spotted oak borer. And a lot of the insects I talked about last week were like aphids, mealybug, scale, whitefly, these common sucking insects that get on the tender new growth of shrubs. Every spring when your citrus flush new growth, you'll get a lot of aphids on it, you'll get whitefly, you'll get mealybug or other scale type insects. Well, there's another group of insects that I didn't talk too much about. I showed you one, the polyphagous shothole borer, which is a huge new pest in the San Gabriel Valley all the way down into Long Beach, actually. But there's also a very important new pest down in San Diego County, down in northern San Diego County, and it's called the gold-spotted oak borer. And maybe if we go to an overhead, I'll show you on this box. I was at a meeting just recently at the Huntington Botanical Gardens on August 29th and 30th on emerging insect pests in California, especially for trees. And the gold-spotted oak borer was one of the featured insects during the whole conference. And we talked a lot about Asian citrus psyllid. I mean, the speakers talked about a lot of things. They talked a lot about polyphagous shothole borer. But they also, you know, was a lot of the long talk and long discussion about this. Let's go to the overhead and I'll show you what this looks like. The gold-spotted oak borer, here it is here. It's not nearly this size, but it has these six yellow spots or golden spots on its wings, three on each side. And it's attacking California coast live oak trees down in northern San Diego County. And there's been a tremendous die-off in mortality from it. So not so good. And when it exits the tree, let's just keep that camera there. It, you know, goes into the tree, the larvae feed inside the tree, and then when it exits, let's go to the overhead again, and I'll show you what to look for. Now, it's currently not in LA County or even in Orange County. So let's take a look at this piece of wood, and you can see this little tiny hole right there. That hole is an exit hole for the gold-spotted oak borer. When I was at the meeting, they gave away these kits that had, you know, this little piece of bark from a tree that was killed. And let's see what else is in the kit. Now, what can you do about this pest? Well, unfortunately, not a whole lot. Wood borers or wood-boring insects are some of the most destructive and most difficult to control. So there are pine bark beetles. There are various wood borers. Now, some of them are kind of harmless or don't do, you know, that much damage. But if you look in this little kit that they were passing out from the University of California Extension, they've got all sorts of fun stuff. And it was really meant for people to take this kit out and educate the public about oak borers. You know, if we go back to the top of this box again, I want to point out a couple things while I just grab a couple things here. If we could go to the top of this box again. Here's the larval stage here. And here. So they're little tiny white grubs that are inside, and here's some more of the gold-spotted oak borers. They are quite small. Then there's an exit hole over here in these pictures. So this is a nice little box. And then this is what happens to trees. Let's go to the overhead again. This is what happens to oak trees that are attacked by a gold-spotted oak borer. And there's a great discussion about where they came from, how they got to California. Well, let me turn this around. And that's what a California coast live oak looks like after it's been attacked by a gold-spotted oak borer. Now, it takes a few years to kill the tree, but you can see this tree is dead. And they've had a tremendous mortality down in northern San Diego, in the Cleveland National Forest in northern San Diego County. Just recently, it was discovered in the mountains up in Idlewild. And it's a long way. Now, this beetle, the gold-spotted oak borer, doesn't move very well by itself. It can only move a short distance. It doesn't tend to take off and end up 10, 20, 30 miles away on its own. In fact, it can't do that. So how did it go from, well, first off, how did it get to California? It is native to Arizona. How did it get to California? How did it get to Idlewild? It got there on firewood. When these trees are cut down after they die, people take the firewood, they throw it in their vehicle, they drive 100 miles, they get it out, they burn some of it, they leave some of it behind at the campsite, the borers come out of that wood, and you've introduced it to a new location. So you should not be moving firewood around California. You should not be buying, particularly buying firewood in San Diego County and driving it up to the Sierras or driving it up to the San Gabriel Mountains or the San Bernardino Mountains. That's really, really a bad idea. And here's a little flyer on gold-spotted oak borer. And really the message, the take-home message is burn it where you buy it. If you want firewood when you're going to go camping, go to where you're going to go camping, buy the firewood there and burn it there. Don't buy firewood up in the Sierras and then have a few pieces left over, throw it in your car and drive it back to Los Angeles County or Orange County or San Diego County or back to Southern California, because you're going to be bringing, almost guaranteed, you're going to be bringing something in that wood back. Very, very likely. Now, just to show you one other picture of this gold-spotted oak borer, let's go to the overhead again, because I want you to get an idea how big they are. They're about a half an inch. I believe they're about, well, it says 7/16 of an inch, so it's about a half an inch. And here you can see a penny with two of the gold-spotted oak borers next to it. Now, I've had people call me up and tell me, and here are the larvae, by the way. Here are the larvae. These are inside the tree. Here's some more pictures. Here is some of the galleries under the bark. And then more damage to a tree. So it's a big problem now in San Diego County, in northern San Diego County, in the Cleveland National Forest. The gold-spotted oak borer, there's not a lot you can do. Once the borers are inside the tree, that's it. The tree is almost certainly going to be killed. And there really are no pesticide treatments that will penetrate the wood and kill the borer. It's not that we can't kill the borer with insecticides, it's that we can't get them inside the tree to kill the larva. And you can't go out and treat a forest anyway. So if you've got a new pest that's attacking a California native tree in a woodland, and it's over multiple square miles, 50 square miles, 100 square miles, you can't go in and spray that. That's just, even if we had a product that worked, it would cost millions of dollars, and in the end it wouldn't work anyway, because you just can't go out and kill all those insects. Once they're introduced, they're here. It is believed now that the gold-spotted oak borer was introduced on firewood from Arizona into northern San Diego County. Now, it's been really pretty static there. This got a lot of news over the last 3, 4, 5 years, and everyone was very worried about it, but it didn't seem to be moving. It seemed to be just kind of a big problem right there, but not really getting around to the whole state. And then just 2 weeks ago, I found out they have found oaks killed up in Idlewild by gold-spotted oak borers. Now, they're trying to jump on it and trying to eradicate that introduction there. We'll see. It's going to be awful difficult. It's hard to know. A lot of trees won't show you any symptoms until they start to die. You know, branches start to die, the canopy starts to thin. So it's very, very difficult. You might have them in a tree for a year before you even realize it. So it's going to be very difficult. They've got all sorts of things. It's all about preventing people from moving firewood. Everything in here says oak firewood advisory. Burn it where you buy it. That kind of thing. So don't be moving it around. Some posters on not moving firewood. And it's not the only pest that you could move with firewood. So don't move firewood. It's a really, really good. Now, the state has very limited ability to prohibit the movement of firewood. Now, before we move on and talk about integrated pest management, let me just show you another sample that came in from the Los Angeles County Arboretum. They had a tree there called the genus is Delonix, and it died on them. And after it died, they found this kind of symptom. Let's go to the overhead, and I'll show you what that looks like. And these are what you call powder post beetles. So powder post beetles get in, and they make a very, very powdery, fine frass, very different from termite frass. And then when they leave, when they exit as adults, the larvae are what are inside the tree. And when they exit, they leave a little hole. Now, two different species were found in this. And let me move this down a little bit and show you this hole here, which is quite a bit bigger. See that hole there? That is quite a bit bigger than all these little tiny holes. And that actually, you have two different species of beetle in this dead tree. The question kind of is, did the beetles kill the tree? Well, generally, powder post beetles do not attack living trees. They attack trees that are damaged, or basically dying. This side of the trunk was actually sunburned. And so the wood in here, the bark was killed. And then it was, then the bark beetle, these powder post beetles then attacked it. The other thing is when these beetles attack, let's look at this one. You can see this large hole here. And you can see this staining here and staining here. They introduce a fungus into the tree in addition to the larva feeding on the tree and disrupting the tree. And here are some galleries right in here. I don't know if you can see these galleries very clearly. But they also often introduce a blue stain fungi or various fungi that will stain the wood. And often sometimes, especially in the ambrosia beetles like the polyphagia shothole borer, the larvae are actually eating the fungus that's growing in the tree. And the fungus can often be what's really killing the tree. It can clog up all the water conducting tissue and then prevent the tree from acquiring water from its roots, and then the tree slowly dies over several years, maybe 3, 4, 5 years. So that is powder post beetle on a dead tree from the arboretum. All very exciting stuff. And here's the beetle, here's one of the beetles. I don't know if you're gonna get a close look at it. There were actually two beetles. And let me see if I can pronounce them, because it's always challenging to pronounce the names of insects. This is the western twig borer, was one of the ones that was found in that trunk. And this is it in my hand. Let's see if you can focus on that. It's a big beetle, but it's hard to see on a TV screen probably. And it's Anthoceras corutus. Is the name of this particular beetle. Can we go to the overhead and see if we can actually see it? It's a big beetle. It's kind of hard to see. There it is. There it is. So that's a pretty good size one coming out of that piece of wood. And then the smaller one was Xylolipus perilis. And those are the small holes. And the host was Dahlonyx. But Dahlonyx is a new host for this beetle. These beetles only get into dead wood. Into lumber, houses, dead trees, that's the kind of thing they like to get into. So if you see exit holes like that in your furniture or in any kind of wood product, you should immediately deal with it, because they do a lot of damage to structural wood, they do a lot of damage to anything made out of wood, so furniture. And in fact, I just had attended a lecture on powder post beetles last week, or maybe it was this week, last Tuesday, where they were showing a lot of the powder post beetle damage on very, very expensive yachts, where they're getting into the wood paneling. And a lot of these yachts would be traveling around the Caribbean, and people would buy these little wooden carvings for tourists. When they bring them back, that wood is filled, those little carvings, they might be a bird, or they might be some type of carved animal, or maybe an ashtray, something like that. And then you set it down in your house, and the beetles start coming out of that, and they get into your furniture, or they get into your floorboarding, or they get into the walls themselves. So you have to be real careful about bringing some of those trinkets back from international travel, the Caribbean. Be careful about that, because you could be introducing a structural pest into your home. It might be a good idea to take something like that if you buy it and put it in your freezer for about 24 hours would be sufficient. But most likely, you'd want to leave it there, you know, a few days. And if you freeze them, a lot of these powder post beetles can't survive freezing. Depends on where they're native to, especially. But if they're tropical in nature, they won't tolerate the freezing. If they're from North Dakota, you could freeze them for a year and they'd come out fine. So let's talk a little bit about IPM. We want to talk about integrated pest management. But alas, there is one more sample to look at. Let's look at this sample. Let's go to the overhead. This is a grapefruit tree. I saw this on Friday. And let's take a look at this on the overhead. And you can see, first off, you see all this black gunk right here? And if I just rub it, it actually comes off quite easily. That's called sooty mold. Look at my fingertips are all black from rubbing it. But if I rub it, it comes right off and it's just green underneath. This is sooty mold. So here you can see the sooty mold here. You can see here it's kind of sticky. See how sticky that is? That means that you have sucking insects in the canopy of this tree. Extremely common on citrus and other woody shrubs. Now, if you look down here, you can see this stuff. I don't know if we can get in any closer. Look at the backs of these leaves. Look at the stems. They're covered with a scale insect. Now, I don't recognize the actual scale insect. I don't recognize the species. It's a little funny looking to me. So it may be something quite unique, but probably not. Probably it's just going to be another common scale insect. But I can also see another one. I can see cottony cushiony scale right there. So I know there is some cottony cushiony scale, but there's another scale all over here. Maybe this will just end up being cottony cushiony scale. I don't know. These may be all just young cottony cushiony scales, which is very common on citrus, fairly easy to control with soaps and oils in the spring when you flush. And if you can't control it with that, well, we'll talk about that. That's what today's show is all about, is integrated pest management and the products that are available to you. So let's move on to IPM.
and we'll talk about IPM. So what is IPM and why was it invented? IPM is integrated pest management. Integrated pest management is not organic pest management. Integrated pest management takes everything into account that has to do with a pest and its host, and you use your cultural controls, you use natural enemies, you use when you plant, how you water, how you fertilize, how you prune, and then if you can't get it controlled those means, then you reach for the least toxic of the pesticides available for that pest. The goal is the reduced use of pesticides, the reduced load that goes into the environment from pesticides, but it is not the exclusion of pesticides, because you can't get farmers to live with their crops being destroyed by insect pests or plant diseases or weeds or vertebrate pests or whatever it is, but you can get them to reduce their costs. And IPM is absolutely cheaper than just going out and spraying on a regular basis. Now, with the introduction after World War II of broad-spectrum insecticides that had long residuals, farmers started going out and spraying on a calendar basis. If it was March 1st, you went out and sprayed. If it was April 15th, you went out and sprayed. So they didn't even bother to look for the pest. They didn't bother with how much they were using. The material was cheap. You sprayed it. You got excellent control because they were using some long residual, highly toxic materials like DDT, chlorothalonil, all these rather toxic materials. A lot of that stuff's all off the market. It's all been pulled. Very few of those things are still available, and there's a whole new class of chemicals available for the control of insect pests and, for that matter, plant diseases. Now, historically, this was invented by entomologists. The term IPM was invented by entomologists because they were the ones who were, in terms of insect control, they were going out and spraying on a calendar basis. For plant diseases, IPM, they hadn't coined the phrase, but that's exactly what everyone was doing for plant diseases, because most plant diseases, there aren't good products that will just control it. And if you're trying to depend on one product to control plant disease, it's almost guaranteed not to work. So when plant diseases, historically, number one means of controlling plant diseases is resistant plant material, is developing plant material that doesn't get to the disease, or the disease is minimal in terms of yield loss or destruction to the plant. So often you would have, at universities, you would have a plant breeder and a plant pathologist working together to breed resistant plant materials. And so a lot of the modern tomato lines are resistant to verticillium, resistant to fusarium, resistant to root knot nematode, resistant to some viral diseases. And these modern tomatoes versus heirloom tomatoes are much easier to grow, especially if you've got those problems in your area or in your soil. If you've got root knot nematode in your soil, then how do you deal with it? Well, you can try and grow heirlooms right in there, but you're probably in for a disappointing experience if you don't do something about the nematodes. And there's a lot of stuff you can do about it. And if you've had a problem with root knot nematode, give me a call, because I'll tell you how to deal with it. In addition to using resistant plant material, give us a call, 1-800-339-1193, and call us up and take a guess at what our mystery plant is. Here, I'll show it to you again. This is one of the tropical of this particular genus. So let's go on and talk about the various aspects of how you develop an integrated pest management program for a crop or for maybe your backyard. It's a little more difficult to apply to a garden in a way, because a lot of this depends on education. It depends on knowing your crop and knowing your pest. That's the education component. It depends on monitoring, going out and looking for the pest, and knowing your economic threshold. Now, for gardens, it's more of a aesthetic threshold. At what point has this pest done enough damage to your plants that you want to control it? Or can you live with a little damage on your plants and the pest isn't going to get that bad in the first place? That goes to knowledge, but there, in agricultural production, there is an economic threshold. So if you go out and monitor your pest and you find one insect per leaf, well, with research,
that you need 5 insects per leaf before you're going to have any yield loss. So you continue monitoring because you haven't reached the economic threshold. You don't bother to go out and spray your field, which would cost you a lot of money, because the number of insects is low. One of the most difficult things to do is to get a grower to accept a few pests on his crop and not reach for a pesticide, because maybe historically they know, or through their experience they know, that in a few weeks they are going to have to spray. But this is about timing your sprays when they're most effective and reducing the amount of pesticides you use. So you set action thresholds. Now if you read in Wikipedia on IPM, or if you read about IPM on various websites or in various books, they'll have different criteria or different steps in IPM. But one of them, especially for agricultural production, is to set an action threshold. And you can do this also for your backyard garden. If there's a few aphids and you think, this isn't worth controlling it, or they're all over the plant, you've got to deal with it. So before taking pest control action, IPM first sets an action threshold, a point at which pest populations or environmental conditions indicate that pest control action must be taken. But we moved. So the next is to monitor and identify pests. And so in the past, they didn't go out in the field and look for anything. They just went and got on their tractor, set up the spray rig, and started spraying. Now, of course, you go out with a sweep net once or twice a week, and you sweep it, or you look at the leaves, whatever, wherever the pest is going to be, you look there for the pest. And when you find it, then you start doing stuff. Prevention. Prevention is another important component of IPM, and this happens before you even plant your crop. So let's see. Prevent pests from becoming a threat. In agricultural crop, this may mean using cultural methods such as rotation. And rotating is one of the principal means of controlling plant diseases between different crops. Selecting pest-resistant varieties, planting pest-free rootstock. These control methods can be effective and cost-efficient and present little to no risk. Let's take cotton, for example. One of the major diseases in cotton is verticillium wilt. It does most of its damage late in the season, in the hot heat of the late summer and early fall. If you plant cotton early and harvest before the late fall, you'll minimize the damage to your cotton. So that's a cultural practice that helps you deal with verticillium wilt in cotton. That's just an example of a cultural practice. Also, you could pick cotton varieties that are highly resistant to verticillium wilt. That may be more difficult to do than just saying it. Control. Control, once you have monitored, identified the pest, and set your action thresholds, the next thing is, once you reach that action, how do you control it? Well, there's a lot of ways to control it. You can reach for the pesticides. Now, in your backyard, you might have just one rose bush, and there's a bunch of aphids on it. You can wash those aphids off with a strong stream of water, and it will break their mouth parts, and they'll never feed again, and they'll hit the ground, and they'll die. They'll be attacked by ants, they'll be attacked by other insects on the ground, and they'll be gone. Now the aphids are going to come back quickly because they can reproduce very, very fast. So that being said, washing aphids off is pretty effective. If you've got a lot of rose bushes, if you're a real rose person, then you have 50 bushes or you have just lots and lots of them, washing off every plant is going to take way too long. So now you're probably going to have to spray something to kill those aphids. So what's practical for you in your garden? Depending on what you grow. And we'll look at some products here in a minute. This is actually, I guess this first section I was reading from wasn't necessarily from Wikipedia. This is from the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency. U.S. EPA says set action thresholds, monitor and identify, prevention and control. So the next, actually from Wikipedia, it says acceptable pest levels. That's your threshold. Preventative cultural practices. That's pre-planting, you can look at soil fumigation before strawberry planting as it's a pesticide, but it's also a cultural practice. Before you even plant the crop, you're knocking down the soil-borne pests, and actually you can quadruple your yield by doing that in strawberry. Monitoring, mechanical controls, that's really shouldn't be a separate level. This is under all controls. Mechanical control, biological controls, chemical controls. These should not all be separate. Really, control is control, and these are subheadings under control. So let's take a look at Now, since you're going to reach for your softest pesticides first,
We're going to reach for those soft pesticides. But before we go on to the actual pesticides, I've got some nice video clips that also talk about IPM. Let's go to a video clip. Let's go to our number one video clip, Integrated Pest Management Basics. And let's take a look at this video clip. And when you get back, we'll talk more about IPM. And eventually, we're going to talk about honeybees. So stay tuned.
Pink bugs. Squash bugs. Cucumber beetles. Hey, if you're growing vegetables, sooner or later, you're going to have problems with pests in your garden. Hi, I'm the bug guy here for the University of Maryland Extension, and today I'm going to talk about an approach for managing the pests on our plants, which we call integrated pest management. The integrated part comes from the fact that we're going to combine many different tactics and approaches to manage these pests. Hey, we're going to use cultural controls, mechanical controls. We're going to use Mother Nature's hit squad. We call that biological control. And when we have to use pesticides, we're going to try to use the ones that are most environmentally responsible. And in this way, we can produce really healthy, safe vegetables to eat. Step number one in putting together an IPM program is to build your knowledge base. Learn about your plants. Learn about the proper culture, rates of fertilization. How are you going to make your vegetables most productive? In the case of these beans, this beautiful trellis allowed these guys to grow up and just produce bountiful fruit. The other thing to learn, of course, is the pests that are going to attack these vegetables. In the case of beans, one of the major nemesis are the Mexican bean beetles. So learn about the history of these, learn their damage characteristics, how they're going to affect the plant, and that actually learn what the various life stages of these insects look like. Here's the adult Mexican bean beetle. Once you build your knowledge base, then you're ready for step two in your IPM program. Monitoring is the second step in building an IPM program. Monitoring means the regular inspection of your vegetables, and what we're looking for are symptoms and signs of insect activity. Symptoms are things like the defoliation that Mexican bean beetles are causing. Signs are the insect itself. So right here we can see the eggs of the Mexican bean beetle. Sometimes using a hand lens can really help us see very small insects and their eggs, or even mites that are on leaves. If you monitor often and thoroughly, you can really stay on top of these pests. The third step in building an IPM program is decision making. You've gone out, you've monitored your plants, you detected your pests. Now you have to decide if and when it's time to treat. In the case of this tomato, hey, there are a few aphids on the leaf, but guess what? There are some ladybird beetles eating this thing. I'm not doing anything at all. But in the case of this squash vine, I think I see some squash vine borer in here. A single larvae could kill that vine, so I'm going to have to do something right now. Decision making, that's the third cornerstone in building an IPM program. The fourth step in building your IPM program is intervention. In this case, we're going to use a floating row cover as a preventive tactic to exclude pests. Another preventive technique we can use is the use of kaolin clay. This is applied to the leaves of plants. It makes the plants unfavorable. The bugs simply don't go there to feed. A third intervention tactic is the use of biological control. This is simply using Mother Nature's hit squad, the predators, parasites, and pathogens that naturally occur and can reduce pest populations. When we've exhausted all other tactics, we may choose to use a pesticide to help reduce these populations. What we like to use are compounds that are on EPA's reduced risk list, those that are safe to use in organic gardening. Always read your insecticide label and always be careful when you apply pesticides.
The fifth and final component of an IPM program is record keeping. Record keeping is used to simply keep track of what you saw in your garden and when you saw it. This will help you be prepared next year to figure out when you need to intervene. Also keep track of how well your interventions work. In this way, you'll know if a biological control or a certain pesticide that you used actually did the job. Record keeping is the fifth and final component of a sound IPM program. So that's it, gang. Remember your five steps of your IPM program. Build your knowledge base, monitor your plants, make decisions. When you see those bad boys, smack them down, intervene, and finally, keep records of what you found. In this way, you're going to be able to produce a beautiful, bountiful, healthy crop of vegetables that are really delicious.
So there you got it from the University of Maryland, how they interpret IPM, and that's all very valid. I think some of that goes back to education. Record keeping is really about education. You keep your records, you teach yourself more about the pest. There are a lot of important pests that are you're almost guaranteed to get. Now, the more you grow a particular crop, the more you learn about it, and the more you know, you're going to have a problem at this time of year almost every year because you just do. And let's take citrus for an example. Every spring, right around the beginning of March, you flush new growth. That new growth is tender and soft. You're going to get aphids. You're going to get mealybug. You're probably going to get some scale insects, whitefly, that type of thing. So it's hard to wash off a whole tree. You know, it's not that effective on a large plant. You can do it on small plants, but just washing it off, although it can be beneficial in a variety of ways, you usually have to reach for something else. So let's talk about our first organic pesticides. And let's talk about the first one, which is just soap. And this right here is safer insecticidal soap. Now, in addition to safer insecticidal soap, there's a variety of insecticidal soaps. This is just an example. I'm not endorsing this specifically. It's very effective for what it does. Let's see if we can get a picture of that. I'm not sure. I think we're on the number three camera. There it is. This is safer insecticidal soap. Soaps do two things to insects, especially the soft-bodied sucking insects. The soap itself is a fatty acid, and it integrates into the membranes of insects and causes them to leak, and then the insect dries up and dies. It can also wash off the waxy covering that prevents desiccation. So in both modes, it's actually causing the insect to dry out and die. You can use insecticidal soap, or you can just use dishwashing soap. You can use Dawn, you can use any kind of dishwashing soap. Now, the nice thing about this is it tells you how to dilute it on a regular bottle of dishwashing soap. It's not going to tell you. Now, I've used about a teaspoon to a gallon, not very much. And I have actually burned some houseplants with that, so you got to be careful. I have an email question from Isabel. What will be the most effective natural way to get rid of pesticides in the garden? My garden is always infected and eventually causes all my vegetable plants to die. Well, I doubt if it's the pesticides that are causing your vegetable plants to die. In fact, I'm sure of it. It's not the natural way to get rid of pesticides in the garden. Pesticides today, almost all the ones sold, especially to homeowners, have very short residuals. And in a few weeks, they're gone. In fact, what we're looking at today, soap has really almost no residual. And in fact, soap, and we're going to talk about some others, are what we call contact insecticides. You have to spray it right on the insect to kill it. And tomorrow, after you spray today, tomorrow they can fly in and that soap's not going to do anything to them because it is contact material. It has no residual activity. So how do you get rid of pesticides? Well, if you do perhaps have pesticide residues in your soil, see, usually soils, there's all sorts of microbes. You know, there's bacteria and there's fungi in the soil, there's insects in the soil, and anything in the soil is usually degraded rather rapidly, especially something like soap and some of the other products we're going to look at. So unless you've been applying a lot of pesticides to your garden, it's not likely that you have any pesticide residue in your garden. If your vegetables have been dying, you need to diagnose that. Now you can, that's my job. I'm a plant pathologist. My job is disease diagnosis or plant damage diagnosis. because usually with entomologists, they'll look at a plant, and if there's no insect on it, they say there's no insect on it. Now, if you have characteristic damage from a specific insect that you're very familiar with, you'll see, oh, here's the symptoms. I'm sure that you probably had this insect. But anyway, that's where education comes in. You need to figure out why your vegetable plants aren't doing well. And often when people call me up and they say, my tomatoes aren't doing well, my peppers aren't doing well, my squash, whatever, corn, whatever they're growing, you know, I have to ask a lot of questions. How often are you watering? Did you fertilize? Did you use any manures? Is it getting full sun at least 8 hours a day? Have you been growing the same thing in the same spot for many years? Pull up the plant, look at the roots, send me a sample. There's a diagnostic process, and you've got to go through it to figure out what the problem was. Unfortunately, kind of a knee-jerk, it must be pesticide problem. Usually that's not right. Now you just skip the whole process of diagnosis. And in fact, if you haven't been using pesticides, I doubt if there's any residual in your garden. So that's my, you know, if Isabel wants to, if you have any pictures, Isabel, of your plants, you can email them to me, or you can email them during the week to the station, and we'll bring them up next Sunday and we'll talk about them. Show me specific pictures. Now, I sent some pictures this week into the control room of the red spider mite on tomato. And if they can bring that up behind me, we'll talk about that, because this is a great product to control spider mites. Soap works great on most mites. So this is safer insecticidal soap, but you don't have to buy this one. There's other insecticidal soaps. And what are soaps? They are fatty acids. You look down here at the active ingredient here on the front label, and it says potassium salts of fatty acids, 49%. That's the active ingredient. Other ingredients, 50%, total, 100%. So there's only one active ingredient in this product, potassium salts of fatty acids. That's soap. Now you have to be careful and not use harsh detergents. Okay, if you go get a dish, clothes detergents and put it on plants, you're likely to burn them. So be really careful. Now, the other really common way to control all these sucking insects are oils. We call them horticultural oils. They are light chain paraffin oils, and there's some oils made from other sources too. This is Ultrafine, and Ultrafine is very popular. It's from Sunspray. Sunspray Ultrafine. It's an oil. It acts to smother insects. There's also Volk oil. There's neem oil, there's stylet oil, there's mint oil. All these oils do the same thing. They smother insects and prevent them from breathing, and it kills them. And they're very effective. The caveat on oils is you can't use them when it's over 90 degrees out, because they can burn the foliage. So oils are excellent in the early spring, March, April, May, and perhaps June if we're not too hot. But once we get warm, you have to lay off the oils. Now, growers will use oils a lot. Often you'll add oil to almost any treatment you spray on a plant because it helps it stick to the leaves. We call it a spreader sticker. And it'll improve the efficacy of whatever. So if you use soap and oil, they're more effective than just soap or just oil. And so in the spring, on your citrus or on your shrubs, if you're growing viburnum hedges or various hedges, when they flush that new growth, they'll get all the aphids on them. Often those aphids are going to be gone by the summer, and you're not going to have to respray. So usually it's a spring problem, and oils and soaps are excellent for that. Now, so we've talked about oils and soaps. You notice that they're all dusty and dirty. I've had these for years. I rarely ever use them myself. So let me just set this over here. And what's our next product? This is Easy Gone Multi-Purpose Yard and Garden Insect Killer, and the acting ingredient is permethrin. Let's talk about the pyrethrins and take a look at this. Now, the oils and soaps are organically labeled. This is also organically labeled, which means you can use it in commercial production of organic foods and call your food organically grown and produced. Pyrethrins are made from chrysanthemum. There are pyrethrins and pyrethroids. Pyrethroids are synthetically produced. They're the same thing as pyrethrins, but they're not made directly from the chrysanthemum. Now, it's a specific species of chrysanthemum that's used. They extract the toxic material from the plant. It's manufactured in this way. You spray it on the plant. It is another contact material, which means you have to spray it right on the insect and has little to no residual activity. So if I spray a citrus plant today, a citrus orange tree or a lemon tree, and some aphids fly in 2 or 3 days, this will have no effect on those because it is a contact material. Very effective. Now, often on some of the more difficult insects to control, you might try oils and soaps and not get good control. Then you need to go up a little higher and treat with a pyrethrin. And there's lots of different companies that make pyrethrins. This is just one example. And again, I'm not specifically endorsing this product, but it is an effective product and it works pretty good. So let me see what also I have here. I have a caller and we'll get to that caller momentarily. Okay, here's our, there's two more. Now we're kind of going to go on to chewing and sucking insects. I like to use the oils, soaps, and pyrethrins for most of my sucking insects. Let's go to our caller and see who's on the phone. Terry calling from South Pasadena. You're on the air. Are you there, Terry?
Hello?
Hello. What's?
Yeah, I have a question about my azaleas, and I wanted to know, they're turning yellow, and I wanted to know what is wrong with them, and how do I fix the problem?
Well, the most common reason for azaleas to turn yellow is iron deficiency. Normally, if it's iron deficiency, the new growth will be yellow and the old growth will be green because iron is not mobile in the plant. It can't be moved from the old leaves to the new leaves. That is distinctly different from nitrogen deficiency, where the new growth is green and the old growth is yellow, because nitrogen is mobile in the plant and can be moved from old leaves to new leaves. Now, often with azaleas, the whole plant turns yellow. And so this distinction between old growth and new growth is not so good. So, you know, azaleas and a number of other plants that are commonly grown in Southern California, camellias, gardenias, and now the very, very popular low-chill blueberries, these plants require an acid soil. And the reason they require an acid soil is because of the solubility of iron in the soil. Iron is highly insoluble regardless of the pH, but at higher pHs, it is really, really insoluble. So at above 7, say your soil pH is 8, if you reduce it to 7, you'll increase the iron solubility tenfold. If you go from 7 to 6, you'll increase solubility another tenfold, so 100-fold more soluble from 8 to 6. Azaleas should be in a soil of about a pH of 6.5. 5.5 to 6.5 would be excellent. 7's okay, but you really want to be below 7, 6.5. And it's all about iron. So there's two ways to deal with the yellow foliage. One is to acidify the soil. You can use ammonium sulfate as your fertilizer for nitrogen, and the sulfate will acidify the soil. You can apply iron sulfate, which is a yellow powder, and it will both apply iron to the soil and acidify the soil. You could put on a weak solution of vinegar, which is often very, a lot of people who grow the low-chill blueberries do that every month, because if you don't keep your blueberries in an acid soil, they'll turn yellow. The whole bush will just turn bright yellow.
Okay.
The other thing is to apply, you know, in addition to the iron sulfate, you can use chelated irons, like ironite is one commonly used variety of chelated iron. And the iron is attached to another molecule, and it allows it to be more soluble or more available to the plant than just putting down iron. So now you need to get on it right away. It's best to go ahead and, you know, azaleas have a tendency to go yellow on you very frequently. So this should be something you should probably do as a preventative and apply iron fertilizers like ironite or there's others, there's many in the market. You can apply those probably starting in the spring, March or April, and put them on once or twice or even three times during the growing season, and you'll prevent the yellowing. Once they start to go yellow, you need to put it on about every 2 to 4 weeks until they green up. I would also add a little nitrogen too, because you almost certainly might have a slight nitrogen deficiency as in addition to your iron deficiency. And if you let it go into the winter, if you let it go into December and January yellow, they will not respond. Azaleas will not respond to iron supplemental treatments in the winter months. They're pretty much dormant and they're not taking up anything.
Okay.
So you're going to just live with yellow azaleas until March to treat them. So we're getting close to that cutoff when they'll take up the iron. So you should probably try and put down some iron as soon as you can.
Okay.
And and put it on again in 2 to 4 weeks, and probably sometime by November 1st, you can just stop the iron treatments because it won't take it up anymore. But they can respond very quickly to foliar iron treatments and to soil-applied iron supplements. So now there's the additional chance that you might have Phytophthora root rot on your azalea is very common, but usually you'll get branch dieback, not just yellowing, but big chunks of the bush will start dying. That can be Phytophthora root rot, which is extremely common on azaleas. Now, we talked about controlling sucking insects with oils, soaps, and pyrethrins. Now let's look at this one. This is Monterey Garden insect spray for control of foliage feeding worms, meaning caterpillars, thrips, fire ants, and other listed pests in lawns, vegetables, outdoor. The active ingredient is spinosad, a mixture of spinosin A and spinosin D, 0.5%. So this is 0.5% spinosad, and I used to say spinosad, but everyone I talk to now calls it spinosad. This is very effective and also organically labeled. It's made from an actinomycete that was discovered in a rum distillery in the Caribbean. I forget which island. And has never been found again. So it's quite odd that they found this soil-borne actinomycete, which is a bacteria. And it happens to make this metabolite that kills insects if they eat it. So spinosad is used to control chewing insects, not sucking insects. So if you spray this on aphids, you'll likely get very poor control or no control at all. But if you spray it to control caterpillars, beetles, or grasshoppers, it will be very effective. It's also labeled for control of leaf miner. So a lot of people call in to me about citrus leaf miner, which is very common, almost every citrus around. And you can put out the leaf miner traps starting in June, replace it in July, and probably another one in August, another one in September, 3 or 4 traps through the summer. Some people report that gives you nearly 100% control of citrus leaf miner. But if you don't get good control because you've got lots of citrus in your neighborhood and there's mated females flying in from other trees in the neighborhood, then you might want to spray with spinosad because it works really well at controlling leaf miners. We have another email from Isabel. Is the mysterious plant a yellow hibiscus? No, it's not a yellow hibiscus, but it's a good guess. It's not hibiscus. We have another call. Let's go to our next caller. And it's Ann calling from Los Angeles. You're on the air.
Hello?
Hello. How can we help you today?
Hi. I'm calling about something you said a week or so ago about plants that will grow in very low light and thrive very well. And I don't know, remember what I wrote it on and can't find it. But I'm particularly interested in something that will do that indoors.
Okay.
And I'm perplexed about the mystery plant also. The last thing you showed looked like it was rhododendron, but I didn't know they had yellow rhododendrons in the same family, so I'll be anxious to find out what that is.
You get a gold star. It's rhododendron.
Really?
Yes, it is. And now the yellow one, I showed you two different yellow ones. They're slightly different. They're not the same cultivar.
You're telling me. I was thrown by the yellow.
Well, these are what they call Malaysian rhododendrons or Viria rhododendrons.
Lovely.
And they are native to Indonesia and Malaysia, and they are tender, and they're tropical plants. And they repeat bloom up to 5 times a year. So they're very different from the rhododendrons that most people are familiar with, which was the other one I showed you, which is from the Pacific Northwest. Or, you know, the rhododendrons that are from Europe and the Pacific Northwest are what you think of as rhododendrons, with these big, huge clusters of flowers that come in the spring, and they can be large shrubs, even 10 to 20. In Europe, when I traveled in Europe, I found rhododendrons that were easily 20 feet tall, covered with blooms, spectacular. They're marginal for Southern California. They're hard to grow here. They don't like hot, dry summers. They don't like our our soils, because our calcareous, high pH soils, the soils that are like around 8, they like acid soils, they like cool summers. And so they're a little challenged to grow here. But if you're a real diehard fan of rhododendrons, you can get away with them, but you've got to find the just the right spot in your yard where they get some good morning sun, so they'll be vigorous and they'll grow and they'll bloom, but they're protected from the afternoon sun and the heat of the day. And that's especially true in the hot inland valleys. You could probably give them a little more sun if you're really close to the beach, but you know, I would still try and protect them from, you know, sun in the afternoon, even if I was living at the beach. And when you plant them in the ground, you've got to keep the soil acidic. Our last caller asked about azaleas. Azaleas are also rhododendrons. We call them azaleas, but it's a tribe or a group within the rhododendron genus. So good on that. Now, and maybe I'll talk about rhododendrons more in a moment, but let's talk about growing plants indoors. The problem with growing plants indoors is you just don't have enough light for flowering plants to do really well indoors. So some people bring in grow lamps and try and grow things indoors under grow lights, and they might get marginal success. If you want to grow something to eat on a windowsill or indoors, you pretty much have to grow something where you're eating the leaves. You're not eating the fruit. So it's going to be very difficult to grow tomatoes or peppers or eggplant or something like corn or potato indoors. But you can grow basil. You could grow a coriander or a cilantro indoors. Now, cilantro is usually grown in the winter to get the juvenile leaves that have, you know, which is what we call cilantro. If you grow it in the summer, it's going to bolt and flower and make seed. And then in the seed is called coriander. But basil should do well. I know some people grow maybe some rosemary, especially if you have a very sunny southern window, you could grow rosemary. But that type of plant, herbs are usually your best thing to grow in a sunny window. You might, if you have a southern window that gets lots of sun, you might get away with a pepper plant, but you're probably gonna get small peppers and not very many. But maybe that's all you really need to enjoy that particular plant and have a little plant indoors. But in general, plants that flower and make fruit are gonna struggle indoors and be very difficult to grow. But if you're just growing leaves, then you can do that.
This has been very, very informational. I'm very glad I called, because that rhododendron, that the yellow really fooled me.
Well, and this isn't even the nicest variety of the Malaysian rhododendrons.
It did. The last thing looked like a rhododendron, but I thought I was completely off.
No, you got it. You nailed it right on the head.
And thank you. I love this show.
Well, thank you very much.
I learned so much, and thank you so very much.
Well, thank you for calling, and thank you for watching the show.
My pleasure. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. So rhododendrons, they're great plant material. They're just a challenge for Southern California. But usually there's some place in your yard where it'll get some morning sun. It's the cooler, maybe a cooler spot in the yard, away from the afternoon blast of the heat. So not so good on the west side of your house in the full sun. They'll burn there. The Malaysians, you also have to protect from frost. When I worked at the Huntington and I curated the camellia collection there, we planted Malaysian rhododendrons into the North Vista, in with the camellia gardens. And they did really well there. But I had to pick spots that got that morning sun, but then got afternoon shade. And at the same time, they planted a lot of them up at Descanso Gardens. Well, unfortunately, Descanso Gardens is at higher elevation than the north side of the slope of the mountain. And they get a lot of frost. They get hard freezes up there, much colder. You'd be surprised, it's not very far away, but it's much colder. And so they froze that year, and they lost them all to frost, which was unfortunate. Now, if you get them in the ground and keep growing for maybe 3, 4, 5 years before you get a hard frost, maybe you just get a little frost damage and it'll grow back in the spring. But you gotta keep them acid. You gotta fertilize them 3 times a year. They're very sensitive to salt, so never any manure or anything like that. Lightly feed them. You can use cottonseed meal. You can use cottonseed meal with a little bit of blood meal, 4 parts cottonseed meal, 1 part blood. That's a good mixture for camellias, azaleas, rhododendrons, things like that. We have another caller. Let's go to our next caller. Who do we have for our next caller? Here we go.
What?
Me? Lynn, you're on the air.
Hello.
How can I help you today?
Yes, I'm in West LA, and I have a lot of mildew, and I don't seem to be able to get rid of it. I can't do sweet peas, and my tomatoes go crazy with it.
So you have a lot of powdery mildew on your sweet pea?
Yes.
Every winter?
Every winter.
Okay, well, there's a couple of real good ways to control powdery mildew. Powdery mildew is kind of one of the unique fungal diseases that you can actually spray and control. A lot of fungal diseases, they're deep in the plant tissue. They're very, very difficult to control. They're internal, they're vascular wilts, things like that, where chemical controls don't work at all. But powdery mildews are just on the surface of the leaf. They send down what's called a haustoria into the leaf like this, and then they start drawing the juices, you know, the nutrients out of the leaf, and they can do a lot of damage. So one of the really excellent ways to control it is milk and water. Oh. And you can use 10% milk up to 50% milk and water. You do have to repeat sprays, just like you were using a broad-spectrum fungicide, because the new growth will not have the coating of the milk on it to protect it. What actually happens when you spray with milk is it coats the leaf with the milk, then fungi and bacteria start colonizing that little thin layer of milk, and that is what inhibits the fungi that cause powdery mildew. So that's very effective. Some people have told me if they use a non-fat milk, they get no odor of sour milk, whereas if you use a whole milk, you might get a little smell from it of sour milk. But you can also use any milk product. You can use powdered milk, non-fat milk, or whole milk. The other thing to use would be, there's a new product from, it's not Dr. Earth, it's, I forget the name of the company now, but it is potassium bicarbonate, and it is a registered, organically labeled fungicide for the control of powdery mildew, and the active ingredient is potassium bicarbonate, and that is pretty much harmless to people, totally non-toxic to mammals, and it's very effective. But again, you have to repeat spray, because if it rains, it'll wash it off the plant, or if you get new growth, the new growth is not protected. So that should work really, and sweet peas, that is one of the big problems with sweet peas is powdery mildew. Now your tomatoes, normally tomatoes don't get powdery mildew. What was the symptoms you saw on your tomatoes?
They would get gray and whitish, and they would it would go up the stem and it'd go on the leaves, and then the leaves would die.
Well, if it's powdery mildew, then you can spray with milk and water, or you can spray with the potassium bicarbonate, and that'll work. Now, you'll probably need to repeat spray. The other things, the cultural practices that are really good for controlling powdery mildew are to avoid overhead irrigation. Don't get the leaves wet. Just apply the water at the base of the plant rather than over the top of the plant, because when the water droplets hit the plant, they'll splash the spores all over the place.
Okay.
And they also, wet leaves, usually are more conducive to fungal diseases than dry leaves. So it's better to keep them dry. But the caveat is it's also good to wash off your plants periodically. And I don't know if I've got that picture of spider mite on tomato. I sent it in earlier in the week. I want to bring that up and show it to you. Spider mites are very common on tomatoes, and you get this fine webbing over the whole plant or on the backs of the leaves, and you get these little tiny red dots all through the webbing, and that's a mite. And you can control that with soaps and oils or perhaps a pyrethrin. But for powdery mildews, you've got milk and water, and you've got the potassium bicarbonate. And in a minute, I'll remember the name of the company that has labeled and is selling that product, but it's probably available to almost any home garden center.
Yeah, well, a part of the problem is that we have a lot of fog and overcast.
And that usually makes it worse. Yeah, that's...
you'll
see that in the spring.
Spray a lot more then?
Excuse me?
Then I have to spray a lot more.
Well, I don't think you should have to spray more than every 10 days, which is
okay.
A lot, really. You might be able to get away with spraying just twice a month.
Okay.
And
thank you.
As soon as you see it, the other caveat, the other important issue on powdery mildews is to spray at the first sign of the powdery mildew. Don't wait until the plant's covered with it, because then it's really kind of too late. And if you spray, that's where, when you talk about IPM, monitoring. And I'll just relate this to what they do in grape for powdery mildew, because in grape, and I forgot another product, and I'll mention that product too. In grape, powdery mildew is one of the number one problems in grape production. And if you don't jump on it right away, it will really damage the grapes themselves. It will reduce yield. It will reduce quality. And it's difficult to control. So they're out there in their vineyards every week, two, three times a week, monitoring for powdery mildew in the early spring. You get that flush of new growth, probably in March. You're out there looking. You see the first symptom, which on grapes is a little odd. It's not like on roses and what you see on the sweet peas and perhaps on some other hosts. But on grape, it's on the stem. You'll see this black kind of creeping lines. And then eventually it's going to get all white and fluffy all over the grapes and all over the tops of the leaves. But as soon as you see that on a stem, the first thing they use is sulfur dust. And sulfur dust is very effective at controlling powdery mildew. And you can use that as well. You can use sulfur dust. You can only use sulfur dust when it's cool out. It's kind of the same caveat as I mentioned for the oils, is the oils will burn over 90 degrees. Sulfur dust will also burn on a hot day over 90 degrees. There's also an oil that's very good for powdery mildew, and that's neem oil. N-E-E-M also has antifungal activity in addition to smothering insects. So say you were going to spray with the potassium bicarbonate, you might add a little neem oil and hit it with both, or alternate. Use the potassium bicarbonate, or maybe use the sulfur first, then use potassium bicarbonate, and then use neem oil. It's always good to alternate your chemistries or your mode of action, although generally in people's backyards you're not going to see resistance growing up and being a big problem like you do in agriculture. It's just different settings. You're not a monocrop in your backyard. You're not spraying frequently the same product over and over many years, which is the kind of the mechanism or how you set up a resistance. And resistance is a big problem, and you have to address that in your IPM program. So when you look at grapes, every major vineyard is going to have an IPM program for powdery mildew. They'll probably start with sulfur dust at the first sign of it. They'll probably come in with either perhaps a neem oil. Perhaps they can get the potassium bicarbonate now. I'm sure that's probably commercially available for agricultural production as well. And then there are also some new fungicides, some new chemistries, the strobilins, which are very effective, which have a 20-day residual activity. So that actually helps a lot. They don't have to spray so often and use so much product. And strobilins are very low toxicity material. I haven't talked much about strobilins because they're not really available to home gardeners, but they are available for commercial production. But we finished talking about the pyrethrins. Oh, no, this is spinosad, I'm sorry. We were talking about spinosad, which is for chewing insects, for beetles, for grasshoppers, for caterpillars, very effective, and organically labeled. So we can all be happy about that. Now let's talk about our next organic product, which is specifically for caterpillars. And this is a safer caterpillar killer, and it's a liquid. And what it is BT. And it says here, it's hard to read because it's so small, but it's actually Bacillus thuringiensis, which is abbreviated BT, and I believe it's 12.7%. There it is. This is really excellent for controlling caterpillars specifically. So it's a bacteria called Bacillus thuringiensis, or BT, often sold as caterpillar killer. You spray it on plants that have caterpillars or you know are going to get caterpillars. So one of the more common pests is tomato hornworm or tobacco hornworm. You see both of those on tomatoes. Big, huge, green caterpillars. Of course, they start out small, but then they get big. They pupate and they turn into sphinx moths. And in fact, I can show you, if we have our photo set from Entomology last week, let's bring up the picture of our caterpillars. Let me just glance here for a moment. And I thought I had pictures of caterpillars. Can we find a picture of a caterpillar? I think I sent a couple during the week, but anyway. You get these big green, what they call hornworms, and they just chew the leaves. And you'll notice, you might not actually see the caterpillar first. What you're going to see is the damage first on tomatoes. And the leaves are all chewed up. Bring this up full screen, and this is a hornworm. Now, there's two different hornworms that you see on tomato. And now I'm going to have to go back and remember.
One of the hornworms has this chevron marking on it, or this V-shaped mark. The other one just has a straight line. It'll just be like this. And I believe this is tobacco hornworm, and the other one is tomato hornworm. Regardless, they both do the same thing, and they both turn into sphinx moths. And there are lots of species of sphinx moths. It's not like there's just one species. So, but you can use BT. And also, if you're having a big problem with caterpillars eating flowers, caterpillars, you know, I one year I had a big experimental plot of petunias that I was running an experiment on. And I had caterpillars get all over, I had these caterpillars all over the petunias, and they're eating all the flowers. And when you went, you see all the flowers were, you know, oh, bring this one up full screen, and this is the other one. And maybe they can tell me on the screen. They found this on the internet. You can see this just has a straight line. So those are the two kinds of hornworms you get, and they are sphinx moths, and they're beautiful moths, by the way. So before I move on to our other insecticides, I want to run another video clip, and let's take a look at our next video clip, which is IPM in agriculture. And I've got some, and I want to talk about colony collapse disorder a little bit, and then maybe spark some more phone calls. So IPM in agriculture. Let's take a look at this video clip to talk a little bit more about IPM, because usually when you develop an IPM program, it can be very specific for a very specific pest on a very specific crop. Let's look at this video clip.
Nuts has risen sharply in the last decade. The demand for produce grown with fewer pesticides is also on the rise. Along with this new demand, farmers are finding that total reliance on pesticides may cause problems such as pest flareback, pesticide resistance, and groundwater contamination. An increasing number of farmers are turning to an effective approach to pest control, which helps reduce and sometimes eliminates the need for traditional chemical pesticides. It is called Integrated Pest Management, or IPM. IPM incorporates all the methods available for pest control and uses techniques that consider both short-term and long-term effects. In this video, we'll explore why IPM was developed and learn its basic strategies. We'll then see how these strategies are applied in orchards, vegetables, field crops, and strawberries. As with any successful IPM program, it is important to begin with healthy pest-tolerant varieties. Once the strawberry planting is established, it is crucial to begin monitoring for key pests such as spider mites, Liguus bugs, and flower thrips. Two spotted spider mites are found on the undersides of leaves where they feed and lay eggs. When two spotted mite populations reach damaging levels, the strawberry plant becomes stunted with reduced yields and lower quality. In controlling two spotted mites on strawberries, cultural, biological, and chemical means must be considered. Dust from surrounding roads encourages the buildup of spider mites. Therefore, water is applied to the roads to prevent dust. Predatory mites, Phytoselus persimilis, are released annually, early in the season, and monitored throughout the year. When necessary, selective miticides are used in conjunction with the predatory mites for a quicker knockdown of the pest mites. Liguus bugs damage strawberries by feeding on developing seeds, which causes misshapen fruit and reduced yields. Vacuuming techniques have shown promise in reducing populations of Liguus from strawberry fields. The Liguus vacuum is a tractor-mounted suction device which moves over the plant canopy, sucking up Liguus. It is used once or twice a week during the period when Liguus populations are the highest. With the integrated use of predatory mites, selective miticides, and vacuum machines, naturally occurring predatory insects increased to levels capable of controlling the western flower thrips. In this video, we've seen and heard how the practice of integrated pest management is employed in orchards, vegetables, field crops, and strawberries. All of these examples show how the use of the complete farm ecosystem can produce crops just as well as chemical-intensive farming. We've seen how IPM often reduces pesticide use, thereby increasing environmental and worker safety. Integrated pest management in agriculture helps farmers increase their overall pest control while sustaining their land for many generations to come.
So, we've covered a lot about IPM, what it means, and how you implement it, but it can be very, very specific. In agriculture particularly, it's very specific, and it's interesting. You know, often when you're trying to control one pest, and if you go to a broad spectrum insecticide and apply it to the field, you'll kill that pest. But you often kill predators that are controlling a different pest. Then, a few weeks later, that different pest, its populations explode. So you often have to take into account not just the pest you're trying to kill, but all the other pests that are potentially going to become a problem if you go to broad spectrums. Broad spectrums are a last resort. If you have a heavy infestation that's just really damaging your plant material, then you're probably going to have to reach for some of the broad spectrum materials that'll bring it under control and save your plants. And some people just give up and say, I'm not going to grow that plant. And there are a lot of examples of that. But let's take a look at this. Here's another product. This is from Easy Gone, multi-purpose yard and garden insect killer. The active ingredient is permethrin. We talked about pyrethrins. This is another pyrethrin product. Let's talk about... there are a handful. You know, we had the one caller who asked about controlling powdery mildew. If you're trying to control powdery mildew on, say, a non-edible crop, you might be more likely to go ahead and use this product. This is called Funginex. Funginex is widely available at almost any garden center. Very effective at controlling a variety of fungal leaf spots, powdery mildews, black spot on rows, things like that. So it has a rather limited application because it's really for fungal leaf spots and powdery mildew. If you're growing roses and you're having this big problem with powdery mildew and you're not getting good control with either neem oil or milk and water or the potassium bicarbonate, then you might want to reach and use this. I bought this bottle quite some time ago, and I don't think I even have opened it because I rarely use these products myself. I just kind of live with some of the damage. Let's talk about Roundup. Roundup is used to control weeds. You can use chemical controls for weeds. Roundup blocks the shishimic pathway in plants. It's pretty much non-toxic to mammals. You'll read a lot of people bad rapping it. They don't like it. They think it's horrible for people. The truth is that Roundup is pretty benign chemical. It's not that bad. It has a very short residual activity in the soil. It breaks down rather rapidly. A lot of the research you might read about or things you might find on the internet I got to tell you, I think they're wrong. Some of it's pretty much just junk science. But I do spot treat with Roundup for Bermuda in my backyard. For a long time, I didn't use it at all. But actually, the way I'm controlling my weeds now is very limited use of Roundup, just spot treatment here or there when I see Bermuda coming up. What I've done, especially around my fruit trees, where I don't want anything growing around my fruit trees, is I put down cardboard and I cover that with 3 to 4 inches of mulch. And that is very effective at controlling annual weeds, cheeseweed, oxalis, pigweed. The Bermuda, it really suppresses the Bermuda, but the Bermuda keeps coming up a little bit over there, a little bit over there, and I have a little spray bottle, and I'll just hit that one little spot, knock it down, because Bermuda is really a tough weed. Some of you might have some shrubs that are growing that you don't want to grow, like poison ivy. And here is Weed Be Gone. This says for southern lawns. Let me see what the active ingredient is. It's hard to read. You put it in very small print, and I can barely read it. But this says for control of weeds in St. Augustine, Bermuda, Zoetius. You know, this is for controlling. This is for broadleaf weeds, so it doesn't hurt grasses supposedly. But again, another full bottle of something. This was probably left in my garage when I bought the house because I never bought this. But that's, you know, typical. You can use herbicides, but be very careful when you're using herbicides. Just if you spray an herbicide and it drifts across your yard and just a little tiny bit gets on another plant, you'll often get very strange growth. You'll get distorted leaves. It may not be enough to kill the plant, but you can do a lot of damage. If you use herbicides underneath trees, the tree's roots can pick it up and you can actually kill part of the canopy or get odd growth or damage the tree. You have to be very careful with herbicides. That's why predominantly 99% of my weed control is cardboard and mulch. We have another caller. Let's go to our next caller. Rosanna, you're on the air.
Yes.
How can I help you?
Hello.
Hello.
Hey, I would like to ask you two questions. And hey, number one, how to kill the aphids on gardenias?
Okay, good question. I just asked you to turn down your TV so we don't get any the sound of the TV in the background. Aphids on gardenias. You can either wash them off with a strong stream of water, which will kill the ones you hit. You could use soapy water. You could use the soap product I showed earlier, the Safer insecticidal soap that you can purchase at almost any garden center. So you can get them at Home Depot, Lowe's, Osh, Armstrong. Any garden center or nursery will carry an insecticidal soap. Or you can just use the Dawn or your dishwashing soap, such as Dawn. But, you know, I don't personally use Dawn. I have cheap store brands because I'm cheap. But anyway, in addition to that, so you can use, you know, you can use soapy water, you can wash them off, or you can use a horticultural oil in the early spring and in the fall, but avoid the oils during the summer months. So there's Volk oil, there's Sunspray Ultrafine oil, there's neem oil. Those are all commonly available from garden centers and nurseries. There's another one called Stylet oil, which is more difficult to find. You'd probably have to try and order that off the internet. But usually if you're looking for stylet oil has good activity against powdery mildew. So a lot of people are looking for stylet oil because they're dealing with powdery mildew, not for aphids. So aphids on gardenias, you know, wash them off or hit them with soapy water or oil or maybe, and if that doesn't work, you could use a pyrethrin. But in general, aphids are one of the easiest plants, insects to control because they're very soft-bodied. They're actually very tender little insects that are easily killed.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And then,
okay.
Do you fertilize your gardenia frequently or hardly at all?
Frequently.
Don't fertilize so much. I would fertilize your gardenia 3 times a year. One of the reasons you might get a lot of sucking insects in a plant is if you're putting down a little too much nitrogen. If you fertilize too frequently, you'll always have soft, tender growth. One of the, you know, the response to nitrogen, of course, is a lot of growth. That new growth is going to be very soft and tender and just perfect for aphids to feed on. So you might want to cut back a little bit on your fertilization and just do a spring, summer, and fall feeding and not fertilize too frequently.
Okay. So normally, how many times I'm supposed to water that per week?
It's in the ground.
Is in a pot.
It's in a pot. And where do you live in Los Angeles? Close to the beach
I'm not too far away from the beach.
Okay, well, you should be able to water. Is it out in the sun or does it get a lot of shade?
It's in the sun.
It's in the sun. Well, I would think once a week you want to water. When you water pots, you want to water the pot until it drains out the bottom.
Okay.
And then I would think that you could water that once a week or even once every two, like, probably early spring, like March, you might be able to get away with every 2 weeks. But then by June, you're probably going to be watering once a week.
Okay.
And if we get hot, like we had that hot spell for the last couple of weeks, you may have to water every twice a week.
Okay.
But that would only be,
you know,
twice a week. Is, excuse me?
So basically, you know, keep it a little bit dry.
Yes, and if you notice it wilts, then you know it's telling the plant's telling you you're not watering me frequently enough. Has it been in the same pot a long time?
For a couple months already.
Oh, that's not a long time. you do want to repot them periodically, either once a year or once every couple years, into a slightly larger pot. And of course, at some point, you're going to get to a pot that's as big as you want to grow it in. But if it's smaller pots, like a 1 gallon pot, dry out very quick, much faster than a 5 gallon pot or a 10 or a 15 gallon pot. But a 15 gallon may be bigger than you want to grow. So you do want to move them up periodically. And if they've been in the same pot a long time, like a couple of years, you need to move them up to a slightly larger pot.
I see.
And give it new potting mix.
I see. Okay. I would like to ask you the second question.
Okay.
And how do I take care of some, you know, yellow powder on the back of the rose?
Oh, that so yellow powder on the back of your... Okay, that is rust. That is a fungal disease.
Uh-huh.
And rose rust is very, very hard to control. Generally, you're going to have to, you can pick off the leaves as soon as you see the yellow, they're what we call pustules, yellow pustules of spores. Mm-hmm. So you can pick off those leaves that have the infection. In the winter, you want to make sure that you prune them hard. You prune them down to like 3 or 4 canes, about knee high. Generally, we're talking about your standard rose bush, you know, not so much climbing roses or some of the other types of roses, but just, you know, floribundas or things like that, grandifloras. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of roses out there. But you want to prune them and then get rid of all the leaves and the cuttings and the trash, get rid of it out of the yard. And then when the new growth starts, you know, monitor it frequently to see the first symptoms of the rust disease. Pluck off any leaves that get infected. I would probably maybe use a prophylactic spray of stylet oil with or neem oil. And you might get some good control with that. But if you don't get good control with that, then you're probably going to have to use something like this, Funginex. There's Funginex, and there's another one called Fungiway. And those are the two most commonly available fungicides that would be effective. And you kind of have to spray about every 10 days.
Okay.
So it's a lot. It's a hassle. The other alternative is to select roses with good resistance to rust disease. And in the past, on roses, the breeding was driven by having the flower color and scent. And very little attention was paid to resistance to powdery mildew, rust, and black spot. Your three fungal diseases are the most common on roses. But now you can get... That's changed. A lot of people don't want to have to spray every 10 days. It's just too much. So, and they don't want to use broad spectrum pesticides, although the fungicides are not the problem that the insecticides are. So if you can, you know, select roses with good resistance, I have some roses at home. One rose will get a lot of rust. The one next to it gets none because that particular cultivar is highly resistant. So now if you're particularly in love with one particular rose, you know, like if you just have to grow a John Kennedy or you have to grow a Chrysler Imperial, you know, then you're probably going to have to spray.
Okay. So how about, you know, the iceberg, the white color?
White on the roses?
Yes.
That's probably powdery mildew. The fluffy white on the leaves and the buds? That's powdery mildew, and you can control that with milk and water, neem oil, or potassium bicarbonate. And so those are all organic. Powdery mildew is actually not that hard to control, but you do have to spray about every 7 to 10 days, especially in the early spring, starting probably March or April. You're going to have to start, as soon as you see the first symptoms of powdery mildew, actually it's a sign because that's the fungus itself. Symptoms are the effect, and signs are the actual agent or the path. You know, so when you see that white fluffy enough, that's actually the fungus itself, and so that's what we call a sign. Soon as you see it start, you have to spray with either milk and water, perhaps neem oil or stylet oil, or potassium bicarbonate, or use a broad spectrum fungicide.
Okay. Thank you very much for your information. I really, really appreciate it.
Okay. Well, thank you for calling, and thank you for watching the show. So, okay, I tend to lose my train of thought when I get a lot of phone calls, but that's fine. I'm trying to think if I have another product I wanted to talk about. And I don't see it, so I think, oh yes, this. And this is our introduction into our next subject, which we may not have a good chance to talk about it this week, but we were definitely going to talk about this. There is a whole class of insecticides called neonicotinoids, and there are a variety of them. The most commonly available one is imidacloprid, and it's getting accused or a lot of people think that it is the reason we have colony collapse disorder in honeybees. I'm not sure that's true, but we'll look at that in depth in a minute. But here you have a Bayer Advanced Garden Rose Care. This will control all the insects on roses for probably the entire growing season. And the active ingredient is imidacloprid at 0.3%. It's hard to read. It's very, very small print, and I need stronger glasses. This is also a fertilizer at 9.14.9. Fertilizes and feeds, insect control, and disease control. So actually, for the people who just called about rose care, if you've got powdery mildew or rust, you could also try this and see if it gives you good control. But the active ingredient, for the insects, it's imidacloprid. And for I can't read it. It looks like it's one of the maybe one of the conazoles. There's actually a conazole in here that will protect against fungal diseases. So you could try that for your roses. You might not want to put this on vegetables because it's all systemic. But this is what you can use for trees. This is Bayer Advanced Garden Tree and Shrub. It is, where's the active ingredient? Active ingredient, 1.4% imidacloprid, which is a neonicotinoid. Now, nicotine itself used to be used in a lot of pesticides. It's very, very toxic material, kills insects really well, and if you smoke cigarettes, you can kill yourself with it too. So you can kill yourself with it if you want, but it's getting harder and harder to put it on your plants because it's being regulated. But this is still for sale in California and the United States, and you apply it as a drench to the soil. You can also spray it in the foliage where it will last for about 30 days, but if you drench it into the soil, it can last up to a full year, and some people report it lasting even longer than that. There is quite a bit of variability in uptake depending on the type of soil you've got. Sandy soils, it's taken up much better than heavy clay soils or soils with high organic matter. It is what we call a neonicotinoid, which means it has the same activity as nicotine. All the nicotine pesticides were withdrawn and are no longer available. There were lots of them 20, 30, 40 years ago, and they're all off the market now. The last use for nicotine was as a fogger in greenhouses, and that's been pulled in California. I don't think there's any nicotine products anywhere in the United States anymore. So they came up with this. Why? Because farmers don't want to spray. It costs a lot of money to spray, and they have to control drift. And drift is a big problem when you're spraying insecticides or spraying fungicides. If the wind comes up more than 5 miles an hour, it's going to blow it down the road. There have been incidents of drift affecting plants miles away. And so if you use this, either as a seed dressing, imidacloprid, I should say, or one of the other related neonicotinoids, you don't have to spray. So you get rid of this whole, flying over the crop or driving through the crop with a spray rig. You can avoid that. You can avoid the expense of that, and you can get good control. And usually one treatment in the spring. Now, imidacloprid is labeled under a lot of labels. For ornamentals, you can either buy this as a homeowner, or if you hire a commercial applicator, they'll use a product called Merit, which is 75% active ingredient. If you buy it as a farmer to put on vegetables or fruit trees, it's sold under the label Admire. So that Admire is labeled for tomatoes and vegetables, citrus, grape, and all that. And you put it down once in the spring, and it will keep all the bugs off your tree for a long time, maybe even up to a year or more. So that's imidacloprid. Now, there's a lot of other neonicotinoids on the market, not so much for homeowners, but in agricultural production. And they are believed to be by some, the cause of colony collapse disorder. And I want to go to our next, before I get into it too much, I want to get into this next video. I don't think I have a caller. So let's go to the video, our third, colony collapse disorder. Well, let's go to our next caller first. Who's our next caller? Liz, calling from Culver City. You're on the air. Hi,
hello.
Liz. Are you there?
Yes, I was calling because earlier you were speaking about the powdery mildew, but I don't think that's what I have on my tomatoes.
Probably not.
I think it's whitefly. My neighbor has a huge hibiscus bush, and I've never had whitefly on my tomatoes, but I do now, and I've tried, like, the organic things. I painted some items yellow and covered the tubes inside with Vaseline because they said it would catch some of the whitefly, but it's not helping, and I've used soap. That's not helping. I don't know what to do. It's just totally decimated my dahlias.
And your dahlias?
My tomatoes are withering, yes.
Yeah. Well, on your neighbor's hibiscus, what he has is probably giant whitefly, which is a very large whitefly. And the nymphs produce wax filaments that hang down under the leaf. It looks like the leaf is growing a beard.
Yes.
And that's the giant whitefly. And the hibiscus is the preferred host. It will go to a lot of other plants, but not quite as dramatically. And there's a lot of other species of whitefly. There's many, many species of whitefly. Whiteflies can be very, very difficult to control. They're very waxy. Wherever they walk, they leave a trail of wax. And so soaps sometimes aren't very effective. So you probably would want to, try a combination of a pyrethrin with an oil. You can use Volk oil or Sunspray Ultrafine oil or neem oil or whatever oil you choose, and with a pyrethrin. And we're cooling off now, so I think you could probably still use the oil. You can do that in the spring a lot easier. In the heat of the summer, you're just going to have to use the pyrethrin alone because the oil will burn the plant. But we've cooled off. Well, remember, we're pretty warm today. But if it's over 90, you can't use the oil. But white flies are hard to control. So the next thing I would try, since you've used soap and you didn't get good control, is try the pyrethrin. On the hibiscus, generally the only way to really get that under control is with a systemic, with imidacloprid or one of the other systemics. And I'm not sure that the whitefly you have is absolutely the giant whitefly, but whiteflies will. There are many species of whitefly that'll go to tomato, that'll go to dahlia, that'll go to all sorts of things. Maybe on your dahlias, since you're just, it's not an edible crop, you might be okay with using imidacloprid under that Bayer Advanced Garden tree and shrub label. Because if you put that down in the spring, you'll control the whiteflies. Now, after we do this next video clip, you may decide you don't want to use imidacloprid, in which case you'll want to use an organic pyrethrin. You could also go with 7-SEVIN, which is carbaryl, on your dahlias, maybe not so much on your tomatoes because that's a broad-spectrum insecticide. So you could try those. But the first thing to probably try is pyrethrin for your whitefly.
All right. I'll try that then. Thank you so much.
One other thing to try is to bring a vacuum cleaner in your backyard and shake the plant and vacuum up all the whiteflies.
Really?
Yes. And back when I was mowing lawns back in the late 60s, in the early 70s, when I was mowing lawns in the San Gabriel Valley, I had a client who used to roll up, she'd take a piece of newspaper and roll it up and shake the, light the paper on fire, shake the plant and flash it underneath them and burn them. Now, I don't recommend you try that.
Especially since it's not my hibiscus, I don't think she'd appreciate me.
Well,
fire.
I'm not sure that the white flies from the hibiscus are the ones you're getting on your tomatoes. Tomato may not be a very good host for a giant white fly. But there are many other species.
Well, the tomato's doing better. The dahlia totally just didn't make it. I tried, and it just totally killed the dahlia.
Well, then I would try the pyrethrin, and if you don't get good control with the pyrethrin, then try the imidacloprid if you're willing to use that. Okay?
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you for your call. We have another caller. Let's go to our next caller. Frank, calling from San Pedro. You're on the air.
Good afternoon.
Afternoon. How can I help you?
Well, I didn't see your program earlier, but I've had some problems growing tomato plants in my backyard. The plants are very large and very full and very healthy, and we develop fruit. Sometimes we use tomato set, but then all of a sudden there's wilting on the leaves, and all the leaves disappear, and all we have is vines with fruit hanging on it. So I tried laying fallow for a few years, came back and tried it again. I made my own tobacco mix, and I've used soapy water. So I let it fallow for a couple of years and tried it again, and we had the same result. And it's a little frustrating to have these beautiful, beautiful plants that are 6-8 feet high and maybe 8 feet in diameter. All of a sudden, all the leaves fall off, and we've got leggy vines with beautiful fruit.
Okay.
So I'm trying to figure this one out.
Yeah, and this is, you know, the process of diagnosis. It can be a challenge. Now, did you see any insects on the plant itself? You didn't see any insect problems?
Well, just very, very light white spots.
Okay. Well, I suspect you might have a fungal disease, and there's a couple of them to look for. There's two in particular. What varieties of tomato did you grow? Do you remember?
Oh, some heirloom, some Better Boy. We tried the disease-resistant types.
And didn't work either?
No.
That makes it tough. But, so, you know, in this situation, I almost, you know, to really figure out what's wrong with your plants, as a plant pathologist, which is my basic training, I kind of need to get your plant in hand. But the first thing I would look for after talking to you right now is I would look for either verticillium wilt or fusarium wilt. And the symptoms are nearly identical, so you can't tell them apart just from the plant. You got to culture to figure which one it is. And you can cut the stem in half, cross-section, and if you see darkening, what we call vascular staining, it's like a dark circle, it could be black or brown, or if you scrape the side of the thing and you see streaks inside there, that indicates you have one of the vascular wilts, either verticillium or fusarium wilt. But if you had resistant plant material and you had the same effect, that kind of tells you maybe you don't have that. Do you grow your tomatoes in the same spot every time?
No, actually.
We rotate?
Some raised bed, we tried them in the ground, we tried them in pots.
You know, it's hard to say. You could have gotten virus. Did you see any distorted growth, any twisted leaves, or distorted fruit?
Not the fruit. We're not getting cat eyes or anything.
Yeah, cat eye is another problem, but, well, this is a hard one to diagnose. I can give you a tip for the winter months. When you're dealing with sorrel-borne problems, especially in tomato or vegetables, annual vegetables, what you can do is there's an organic way to fumigate the soil. You grow cabbage or any coal crop. You can use rapeseed. You can use cabbage. Often this is referred to as green manure or green mulching. And you grow your cabbage. You can start it this weekend from seed or, you know, anytime in the next, you know, month or two, and start your cabbage, grow it up real nice, it'll head up. Right around February, you chop it all up and turn it into the soil to a depth of about 4 to 6 inches, and then tarp it and seal the edges of the tarp and leave it tarped for about 2 weeks. So you want to do that in February. And then that cabbage, that green cabbage, is going to decay in the soil. And when it decays, it's going to give off a chemical. It's the same chemical as an old soil fumigant that is no longer available called Vapam. But this is a natural way to do this. So that cabbage will decay in the soil for about 2 weeks, pull the tarp, turn the soil again, and then you should, you know, probably be pulling your tarps in early March, and you don't really need to plant your tomatoes until mid-March, about March 15th anyway. So by March 15th, you want to let that soil breathe a little bit for a week or two, and then you can plant your tomato plants. Another really good thing to do, especially if you have raised beds, is put down a thick layer of mulch. You can get either bagged mulch or get, since you live in San Pedro, you can get free mulch from the City of Los Angeles Solid Waste Management District. They have 10 distribution sites to give away free mulch. All you have to do is go there and get it and bring it home. So you're going to need some way to move it, trash cans or a truck or something. And put down 4 inches of mulch and turn it to a depth of 4 inches, so you have an 8-inch mix of mulch and soil. And if you put in all that cabbage and let it decay, that will help knock down root knot nematode. It will knock down Phytophthora root rot, verticillium, and fusarium wilt. It's a real good way to knock down any pathogenic problems in the soil. Do you have any of your tomato plants this year?
Say that again, please.
Do you still have some of the tomato plants that are having this problem?
No, we turned them back into the soil.
You know, it's a good idea if you've got a plant a problem like that is to put them in the trash and not turn them in, because it's very likely that you've got some type of fungal disease and that you're just increasing the amount of the propagules from the fungus in the soil when you turn them back in. You could compost them in a compost pile.
We actually have mulchers in the back, so we make our own mulch.
Yeah. Well, I think with those tomato plants, I would keep them out of your mulch. Have you pulled them up and looked at the roots? Were they lumpy and all? You said they were 8 feet tall. That kind of tells me you probably didn't have root knot nematode.
No, it didn't look like there were any nodules or anything on them.
Yeah, because normally, you see, when you have root knot, the plants are stunted and they're only half normal size. How often do you fertilize?
Every week, but it's a watered down version, and we add a little bit of hormone growth to it. The fertilizers we use, I usually put blood meal and bone meal in and layers of newspaper first and turn that in as a base, and then use a liquid like 10 drops to a gallon once a week.
Okay, well, light fertilizations frequently are fine. The blood meal and the bone meal are excellent, so is cotton meal. You want to be careful about over-fertilizing because if your plants, but you got a lot of fruit, didn't you? You got a lot of fruit set, and then the plants collapsed. They didn't do well.
Yeah, not because they didn't have enough iron, then they were leggy.
Well, I think, I think you'd probably need to, now you don't have any right now, but if you're going to plant tomatoes next year, you're probably going to need to send some of your plant material once it shows it's symptomatic. Once you're getting this problem, you need to send me the plants. My full-time position is with the Los Angeles County Agricultural Commissioner, where I run a plant diagnostic lab, and I'm the plant pathologist for the Ag Commissioner. So we're in Southgate, and you can mail the plants in, or you can drop them off. Our services are free to the public. But for this kind of a problem, it's hard for me to diagnose it. It seems a little cryptic, and it's hard to understand why you would defoliate. You didn't get any, it's just a tough one. It's a tough one to diagnose without the plant in hand. So I could take a look and maybe culture some of the plant. So you could culture the roots. I could culture the roots. I could culture sections from the stems. I could see what the exact problem was. But it doesn't sound like you're doing anything real wrong. Have you used any manure?
No, I haven't used manure. It's mostly been the mulch. I bought some composted product from Kellogg. I think they use human waste for that today. Yeah. I'm not sure.
Well, the thing about cow manure is it's very salty. And so stay away from cow manure. Cow manures will raise your salinity in your soil dramatically in a, over time, and not a very short time, of just a few years, you'll really be dealing with a salty soil. But try the cabbage this winter in your raised beds. Turn it in, tarp it, add some more organic matter after that, and then try your tomatoes again. And did you have any peppers or eggplant also that had the same problem?
No, we just grew some organics and heirlooms and several kinds of small tomatoes, the hundreds, of course, and baseball tomatoes, which look like cucumbers, and it was more of a test this year if it would come back again.
Yeah,
and it did.
So.
Well, if you try them again next year and you have plants that are symptomatic, this is a case where I've got to have the plant in hand to give you a definitive diagnosis.
Thank you very, very much for taking the time, and yeah. I will come by Southgate.
Look us up on the internet. Just put in there Los Angeles County Agricultural Commissioner. You can find my phone number, and you can call me at the lab. Or I can tell you right now, it's 562-622-0434. Give me a call. I'll give you the mailing address, and you can either bring them by or mail them in, and then we'll try and get an answer for you. Okay? Now, I got one more call. Let's get to this call before we run out of time. I've only got 2 minutes left. Let's go to William calling from Winnetka. How can I help you today? Did we lose William? You there? I think we lost William. Well, I really wanted to talk about a colony collapse disorder today. And I'm going to push this discussion off until next Sunday. But we are going to talk about honeybees and colony collapse disorder. I can just briefly give you an overview of what's going on. But a colony collapse disorder is basically when the bees leave the hive and they don't come back. So what's causing this? It's not that easy to diagnose. If you go on YouTube and you look at all of these videos, you see a lot of people blaming it on neonicotinoids. But you'll also see that a lot of people recognize there's more than just that going on. We've got the varroa mite. We've got the mite vectoring viruses into the bees. We've got loss of habitat for them, you know, to range. We also have just the general practice of moving beehives around. And I was hoping that we could talk to a beekeeper today, and I wanted to ask him some questions about how he's doing with his bees. One of the things that's very stressful for bee colonies is to move them. And that's the bulk of beekeepers are moving their beehives around from crop to crop and renting them for pollinization, especially in things like almond and citrus and crops like that. You bring the bees in when the trees are flowering, you get much better pollinization, you get a bigger yield. It's very important for the ag industry that these bees are available. But we've had a tremendous die-off over the last 6 years, losing sometimes 30, even 50% of the hives over the winter. And there is evidence that the neonicotinoids disrupt the ability of the bees to come back and find the colony and return. But that also occurs from the viruses, from the deformed wing virus. And there are more severe forms of that virus. Plus, the varroa mite itself can kill colonies very, very efficiently. But there is a big difference between feral colonies or wild bees and bees kept by beekeepers, because they can do all these things to help the bees. They can supplemental feed them, give them extra protein, do all these things to help them. But they have to put miticides into their hives to control the mite, and some of those miticides actually have the same effect that some of the neonicotinoids have, which is inhibiting their ability to return to the hive, their ability to navigate. So we are going to talk more about colony collapse disorder next week. We'll probably start off with that so we can get to it, because I think it's such an important topic. I haven't talked about it in the past. I'm going to do more reading on it myself, because there's an awful lot of literature out there on it. So if you want to call in and talk about it and complain about it or give us your opinion, call in. I would just say that if you're out there, there's the report on the National Stakeholders Conference on Honeybee Health from October 15th to 17th, 2012. Here it is. It's not a small report. It's pretty thick. Take a look at that. For the students, read about oaks. We're going to talk about native oaks next week. Until then, I wish you happy gardening. This has been Gardens of California. We'll see you next Sunday.